That's just a stupid party, man.
Yeah, brother, like, solid. Right on.
Brother, brother, there's far too many of you dying. You know we've got to find a way to bring some loving here today. Father, Father, we don't need to escalate. You see, war is not the answer. For only love can conquer hate. You know we've got to find a way to bring some love and here today. Picket lines, sister, and picket signs, sister. Don't punish me, sister, with brutality, sister. Talk to me, so you can see, sister. Oh, what's going on?
What's going on?
What's going on?
What's going on?
Yeah, what's going on?
What's going on?
Oh, what's going on?
What's going on?
Good morning, afternoon, evening, whatever time you're tuning in the program called What's Going on FlintTalkRadio.com. I'm George Moss, the host of the program, and I'm very glad to see this afternoon. After being off last week because of the holiday weekend, my co-host is Ms. Kathryn Hunter Williams. And Kathryn, I always am very happy to see you when you're here because for some reason, the program goes a lot more smoothly when you're here.
Maybe because you got somebody to sound off with and also had a different view than you, an opinion.
That's good to have. Yeah. I like the fact that we have people that think that are thinkers, and it's not about agreement, it's about someone who has a steady view. And, you know, and I'll tell you something, that's one thing that I noticed last week at the book, the study group.
Okay.
I thought that was a really good discussion we had last week because there were four people. We didn't have a large number of people there. But what was really impressive was that everybody had so much input to place on the table. And I walk out of the study group.
We're not a book club. Yeah, we're still in the same book.
And we're going to be in there for a while if we don't get past these conversations.
Yeah.
But, you know, it was just so inspiring to have the kind of minds around that table.
And let me confirm what it is. It's called the Comet Study Group. Professor Moss is our discussion leader, and it's held at Page's Bookstore every second Thursday at 5:30.
So if you can spare one Thursday out of the month from 5:30 to 7 o'clock, we'd like to have you come out and join us. We have a very good group. I think we have one.
We have all kind of type of people there.
Yeah, we do.
Not many whites.
Mm-hmm. And it's open to all people.
And
we're not talking about having to be a scholar to be a part of this group. We just want to open up to the community and invite you to come in and share in the understandings we have and give us your understandings. We can always learn something.
It was very interesting because Professor Moss was telling us that we were doing a chronological study of Dr. Asa Hillard, and it was really off base. So now we're going to try to straighten this out because the reason it was off base is because of the updates and evacuations and different things, all kind of things are being found out. And so they had information that was wrong. But I just felt that was the information at the time that he could find. So we're moving on, and Professor Moss gonna keep us up to date on what's going on. We be on him.
Yeah, it's a team. You know, it's a team sport. You know, it's a team activity. The people in that study group are some of the most dynamic persons in Genesee County.
Elvin will be back too.
What happened to Elvin last?
He had to go to Muskegon, and he couldn't get back to the study group.
Okay, we'll see Evan in October.
Yeah.
Kathryn, you know, last week, I didn't want to miss the program, although it was Labor Day. I came in because I wanted to continue to talk about the Glenn Beck rally that was held in Washington August the 28th. And I wanted to come on the air to also commend the viewers for the comments that they have actually written in about the program that we did the 30th of August,
mm-hmm.
and this program that we did on the rally that went on YouTube, so it went national, and we've gotten about 2,000 hits, something like 1,954 hits or so as of this morning. And it was something that...
That's awesome.
We had not anticipated that this would be placed on YouTube when we did the program.
But see, I always thought that we were automatically on YouTube, but I'm finding out we're just on Stickam, and that's local and national. Am I right, John?
It's, well, so you can access it internationally, of course, because it's on the internet. But typically, it was like people were finding you guys just from coming in for, you know, into local. But see, we were thinking, too, to expand the, you know, the viewership, we should do that. The, you know, some shows we can't do that with because they have a lot of copywritten material on their show, and they would close Stickam, and YouTube doesn't allow that. You know, they don't allow they shut your account down.
Okay.
So, like, some people have a lot of music and stuff like that. It's pre-recorded from other artists and stuff. They would. So now we're seeing that we could do this more. We're putting it up on YouTube, and YouTube is like, that's a great way for you to get your word out. It really is.
Well, it seems this show is a hit.
It's getting bigger.
What's
it's
going
getting
on?
Bigger. It's getting bigger.
Yeah.
Well, I'm really happy to see that. We want to also apprise the viewers that we want viewers to call in. We want to hear from the person listening to the program, hear what you have to say, and add to the conversation. We always, we used to have, I think his name was Jim, that would call in, and we would stop whatever we were doing, and whatever Jim wanted to talk about.
Well, he likes the politics that you speak about, you know.
Yeah.
The economy and Obama's health plan.
Yes.
That's what he liked.
Let me tell you some things that have happened around the rally, the Glenn Beck rally. Kathryn, I was watching all the fudging, the misrepresentation of the information that was really the accurate information that should have been reported by the media and how they were slanting this news. The numbers, first of all, CBS saying there were 87,000 people in that mall, and it's probably about 87,000 people in that mall about 6 o'clock that morning, and the rally didn't start at 10 o'clock that morning. And anyone standing in that mall at the time that the events were going on and said there were 87,000 people, it's just a total misreading of the, and I think purposefully so, misreading of the numbers that were there, because there could not have been less than 500,000 persons that were in that mall. But another thing that I noticed as I began to continue to look at what was going on the internet,
mm-hmm.
I was watching how they tried to frame what occurred there as something that spun out of control and led itself to violence. They had one person that did a camera trick where they were, in fact, shaking the camera up and down, like they were filming an actual episode of violence. And it would that one would be 20 seconds long.
I hope the people know the difference, that it was the camera.
I pointed out last week that this was a camera trick, trying to act like there was a violent event that took place at the Tea Party. After all...
like a running or something?
Yeah, after all, Ben Jealous, the head of the NAACP, had said at Sharpton's rally that Glenn Beck had asked his followers, those who were going to be in Washington the 28th, to leave their signs at home and also to leave their guns at home. And I challenged Ben Jealous last week in this heinous, this civil rights movement. The NAACP has become a travesty under Ben Jealous's leadership. And Ben Jealous cannot produce, because it doesn't exist, anything where anyone called for tea parties to leave their guns at home. He was saying leave the signs at home because he didn't want to give the liberal media anything to talk about, because they were trying to look and see what kind of signs they're bringing, and they didn't bring any signs. And then when they didn't bring any signs, then not having a sign became an issue in the media. They were saying they didn't bring any signs because they didn't want anybody to know what it was they were representing. So you can't win for losing, because they're going to slant it one way or the other to their benefit. And I pointed out last week the benefit to them is most of these persons are collectivists, and they want to show that this country needs to be transformed from what it is now to something very different. They want to carry this country down the road of socialism and this idea of fundamentally transforming in this country. Why does it have to be transformed in a fundamental way? Why not transform it by going back to some of its roots?
Professor Moss, I'm going to interrupt. You can finish talking. I just want to go over here and turn this fan on.
Okay.
I got to have some air up in here.
What they're talking about is taking the country from its moorings, taking it off of its bearings and place it somewhere else that it's never been before, and carrying it down to a place where other nations have gone, and
now they're trying to backtrack
to where they were before they went down that road.
Thank you.
A case in point is Britain went down the socialist path, tried to socialize their medicine. Now they're returning back to their moorings. You know, this camera here just went down.
Yeah, John, this camera just went down. Oh, you did that? Oh, okay.
Okay. We have
he said, okay.
We didn't have the air on.
All right, Nano, spook up in here.
I think there are ghosts in this room.
I swear there is, because that was a pretty tight in position. So I don't know how that slipped down.
Yeah. I'm sorry. What you say?
I had that tightened down, that collar on that, you know, the sleeve for that collar. I tightened it down pretty good, so I don't know how it slipped down all of a sudden.
Yeah. Oh, okay. Yeah, it may be a ghost up in here.
Yeah, we were just...
He's letting us know.
Yeah, I'm just saying that
they're
collectivists that want to take this country down a pathway to a road that has not worked anywhere in history, and it certainly cannot be pointed out where it's working anywhere in the universe today. I mean, there are a lot of socialist countries that have tried the socialized medicine, for example, and this pathway that we're now traveling down towards socialism, and I'm just trying to have anyone that's arguing that. Where's that? Where can you point to a model in history or a model in the contemporary setting where that's actually worked?
But how can, I keep hearing that this country is going towards socialism, but we're a democracy, right?
No, not a democracy.
We're a democratic country.
We are a Republican form of government, which is what
it's called.
Okay,
Republican form of government.
Of the Constitution.
But that's not...
No, it's not a democracy. A democracy is something different. Democracy is where you have, for example, in the Greek society, where all the people are standing in a room and each one is hollering out their viewpoint and everybody has to be heard before a decision can be made.
Well, I thought that's what we did.
No, we have a representative form of government.
Really? Yeah. I'm learning something here this morning.
Yeah, the Constitution calls
for... This afternoon?
The Constitution calls for, and this is Article 4, it says that the United States and all states therein will have a Republican form of government. What that means is that you will then go to the poll, as we'll be doing on November the 2nd,
mm-hmm.
and we'll be going to the poll, and we will, in fact, be electing our representatives.
See, now that's what I thought it was, a democracy.
That's not a democracy.
That's our view, our opinion, or whatever. We're voting for who we want.
See, if it were a democracy, what would happen is that when we said we didn't want the health care, where you had 60% of the American people saying they didn't want it,
It would not have happened.
It would not have happened.
Oh, okay.
See, the representatives.
We didn't have no vote on that at all, though.
No, the representatives are supposed to be speaking in our voice. So we give them our voice by voting them into office,
mm-hmm.
and they go to Washington. This is the theory. They go to Washington and therefore represent our voice in Washington. But they're tone deaf up there. But we're gonna help them increase their hearing in the upcoming election. I think you'll be able to hear. You'll be able to get with that Verizon commercial where they ask, "Can you hear me now?" I think they'll be able to hear us later on.
So they are trying to take us from the Republic and taking us towards socialism?
Yeah, well, they have more government control. See, socialism is where the government controls the means of production.
Okay, until they take our guns, then I ain't got nothing for the socialism.
And don't give them your guns because this is getting real serious.
That's when it's really serious, when they say, "We want your guns," then it's becoming dictatorship.
You know, the framers were very clear about what it was they were doing and setting up this unique government. It had never been set up in the history of the world before. And what they really were aware of is that you, first of all, have to entitle the people to their rights, rights which are God-given and not, in fact, bestowed upon them by the government. The government doesn't bestow rights. That's another thing the socialists are trying to do, is make it appear that the rights are bestowed upon the citizens by its government. And that's what Glenn Beck was pointing out this past Friday when they were saying that health care is a civil rights. He was saying, he showed a picture of where John Lewis and Nancy Pelosi and others were locking arms and mimicking the civil rights movement. Remember when King
right. rocked arms? But that's not a civil right, well, is it? That's a health issue,
well,
isn't
that,
it?
That's what I'm saying. If he showed that all these representatives were saying this is a civil right, they have made everything
but it's not.
A civil rights. The point that has been made here is that this is a mockery of the civil rights movement. And this is what Alveda King was saying when they're mocking the civil rights movement by saying that this is a civil rights, that the government will in fact give you rights as if rights are bestowed upon people by the government itself. This is an abomination of what the framers had in mind. The framers had in mind that you would in fact have the government to in fact protect the rights that people have because these rights are unalienable. That's why Jefferson was saying in the Declaration of Independence that all men are created equal, that they are born with certain unalienable rights. Unalienable, what does that mean? It means these are rights that you're actually born with.
As a human.
As a human being. Mm-hmm. That there are certain human rights you have, such as life. You have the right to your life. You have the right to your liberty.
To pursue happiness.
And you have the right to pursue happiness.
Yep.
It does not mean the government can, in fact, bestow happiness upon you. You have the right to pursue it mm-hmm. out of your own efforts. And so they have made it appear that the government, that is to say Nancy Pelosi, Harry Reid, Barack Obama's administration and others, can in fact give civil rights to its citizens. Citizenship rights are not given to you by your government. Your government is supposed to in fact maintain the rights that you're born with. We have the right to our integrity, we have the right to life, our liberty, and the pursuit of happiness, and no government can bestow that. All it can do is in fact protect those rights that you have because you are a human being born with unalienable rights.
I am actually just tired of seeing everything become racial mm-hmm. or like that, making that as a civil rights. I don't know when you're going to show this video, but that's a very interesting video. And how they keep our minds focused, and I mean all of us, our minds focus on that this is a civil rights issue, that this was a racial issue, and a lot of times it's not.
It very seldom is it that, but they have to make it that because otherwise what becomes clear is their irrelevance and that they have outlived their usefulness, which by the way...
So do they play only on, is this only on black people? The sympathies of black people using the civil rights and all that?
Playing upon
white
guilt.
Holding arms and... Like this was like
this is Nancy
that
Pelosi
Obama.
Also involved in that and John Lewis, who was in Selma on the 7th of March when they had the beatdown, as I would call it, what is called the Bloody Sunday massacre that occurred when they beat those marchers down. John Lewis is one of the ones who was in fact knocked down and they had horses that you saw the pictures
mm-hmm.
and for him to engage in this kind of travesty that makes a mockery of the civil rights movement is unconscionable and unforgivable for this man who had a
and they play they use record. That though and see that's that when you don't think for yourself.
John Lewis has no integrity left. He's part of this lamestream Congress that's up there right now that is in fact out of control, and he's part of the problem. It's unfortunate that those persons that were once outside the arena of power that were arguing about how power was being wielded in this country would join the power streams and get in there and then begin to mimic and parrot the things that they were once complaining about. It is unforgivable for them to have this betrayal of the civil rights movement. But they're being called on it, and the Tea Party is real, is not going anywhere, and they can lie about it and try to act as if this is something about race when there were 500,000 people that were paying homage to Dr. King's dream. And let me just tell you who has hijacked the civil rights movement. I want to be very clear about it. The ones that have hijacked it, and this is what Alveda King was saying, but she didn't come out with those words, but she was actually lending herself to that voice, and that program she did this past Friday needs to be seen. Mm-hmm. Alveda King, I have to put it in the same context, Kathryn, as I would put Sojourner Truth, Harriet Tubman, Ida B. Wells Barnett, Fannie Lou Hamer. This is a great woman for her to take a chance in coming out for that which is right, and facing all of the attack dogs who've been attacking her.
That's Martin Luther King's niece.
His niece.
Yeah, so
the
just
daughter
clear
of,
it up.
The daughter of Dr. King's brother, A.D. King, who I said last week was named after his grandfather on his mother's side. Reverend A.D. Williams was his grandfather, and the mother was Alberta. That was A.D. Williams' daughter and King's mother. And so A.D. Williams was the name after whom King's brother was named. And it is his daughter that was on that program. And also she spoke at the march on the 28th of August at the Glenn Beck rally in that mall. And I will tell you something. That woman, I didn't know her too well. I knew about her presence.
I had never heard of her until I seen her on that video.
Kathryn, this is a great woman for her to be standing up and almost saying, but not really so explicitly stating it, but you can read between the lines. She's saying that they have hijacked her uncle's dream. And the hijackers, we must point them out. They are the ones who are standing up there talking about they are in the seership. And they're in the custodianship of this civil rights movement, and that they are the ones who are the custodians of Dr. King's vision. They are the ones who are pouring water on that vision.
Are you going to show the video?
I am, and let me just say that.
Okay.
I want to set the video up. But the ones who are, in fact, are pouring water on the parade of what once was the revered vision of the civil rights movement that have hijacked this vision are people like Jesse Jackson, Al Sharpton, and Ben Jealous. And I have to call them out on it because this is a travesty that's what's going on right now in the name of the civil rights movement.
That's why I said keep throwing fire on these on this racism, keeping it alive.
They're keeping
not
it alive.
Not saying that it's not dead, because it is. It's mm-hmm. still alive and kicking. But they play on it.
They play on it.
You know, they
because
use
they have
it.
To they have to make they have to take the departure from the ideals of the nation and then take the suture and then split it apart. Because they can't allow healing, racial healing to go on. Otherwise, they will be seen as irrelevant artifacts.
They wouldn't
that they
get
are.
Paid.
These are relics of history.
They and wouldn't be they getting need paid.
To, they wouldn't be getting paid. And there's money in this thing. Don't
ever,
doubt,
think it's not.
Don't ever doubt the fiduciary aspects of what they are doing out there, because this screaming that they're doing pays big dividends. So that leads us into this video, Kathryn. It's a 10-minute video that I think points out the charade that's being run. I think that this video points out, as well as anything, how we're being misled by this false leadership. This video we're gonna show is between a gentleman out in Los Angeles, Ted Drakes, who is an activist out there, who, by the way, did you know he's wearing
it's
the-
Ted Drakes? I thought it was Ted Hayes.
Ted Hayes.
Okay.
Ted Hayes, who's wearing, did you know he's wearing the African garments?
Mm-hmm.
And I'm looking for, this is gonna be another Circle of Carmichael.
I think he already is out there.
From the conservative standpoint, though, and I was surprised at how brilliant his treatise was, and I was surprised also about his political outlook, because I thought, okay, here's another one of those guys going to be raising his fist up and hollering at the media and all of that, and he came with a very reasoned position. In this,
it was a debate.
In this debate,
yeah,
this is a debate between Ted Hayes and Eric Miller, who is the head of the SCLC.
Eric Lee, isn't it?
You know, I'm getting all these names mixed up.
I think it's Eric Lee, Dr. Eric Lee, who's head of the Southern List Christian
Kathryn,
Leadership.
I sent you.
We'll see you in the video.
No, you're right. You know, I sent you the video, and Kathryn, you're more of an expert on than I am.
I looked at it a couple of times. You don't know, I had a hard time getting it because my Adobe Flash, but it's me. I'm not computer literate, so I had to go through some changes, but I watched it a few times before I actually got it.
Oh, is that right?
Before I got the whole thing, because you sent me three of them.
Yeah.
And I was going to send you back, which one, you know? But then I remember you said his name, and that's how I got it.
Right.
Him.
So the name
debate.
Is not Eric Miller. It's Lee Miller.
I think it's Lee Miller, but, you know, when you show it on here, you'll see.
Okay. We'll see who's right here.
Dr. Eric Lee,
Eric.
Or I don't know.
I think it's Eric Miller, but if it's Lee Miller, I'm going to come back on camera when we get back
it's
from
Lee
the
something. I do know that.
And we'll see what the name is. But this is a very interesting debate between the two gentlemen, and I think you'll see exactly how this movement is being hijacked by these hustlers, and this is what Hayes is saying in this video. If we have it queued up, John, why don't we play that now and let the viewers see this debate.
Temporary difficulty here.
Okay, temporary difficulty. I was going to say that we're not the ones that's going to be debating this issue. John's going to bring that up in as soon as we can get it up for the viewers. I wanted to make sure that you saw this, because I think this makes the point of how much astray this movement has gone from its moorings and from the bearings that it had back in 1963 when King gave his vision not only to the United States of America, but gave his vision to the world.
Okay.
We're now being told that the video is ready. Let's see if we can get it up and running.
Our fighting men and women do the things that most of us don't even want to think about. They do it while we're asleep. They do it while we're at play. The point is, they do it because it is their calling.
If Uncle Martin could be here today, he would surely commend us for giving honor where honor is due.
They told me that others are going to be at the mall, and they're going to be standing where Dr. King stood. Well, they may have the mall, but we have the message. They may have the platform, but we have the dream.
Joining us now to discuss today's rallies is the Reverend Eric Lee. He's the president and CEO of the Southern Christian Leadership Conference, and he says civil rights leaders are not happy with Beck. Also joining us, Ted Hayes, a conservative activist who thinks Beck personifies the dream King talked about nearly a half century ago. Ted, if the Glenn Beck's rally personifies King's dream, expound on that a little bit, and if so, why wasn't the audience a little bit more diverse?
Because for the last 45 years, people like Jesse Jackson, Al Sharpton, basically have hijacked the dream of Dr. Martin Luther King, the civil rights legacy. And they have told black people that white people are racist, they don't care about us, they hate. When these folks got out there in the mall today, they demonstrated the dream of Dr. King, where he dreamed that black people and white people and all races would come together to make America a beautiful place. Al Sharpton does not own that property at the Lincoln Memorial. That belongs to the American people, and anybody, you or anybody, can stand there and try to fulfill the dream of Dr. King and the American people.
I don't think Reverend Lee would argue with that point, but Reverend, what do you say about this idea that Glenn Beck's message personifies King's dream?
Glenn Beck stands in stark contrast to Dr. Martin Luther King. You can clearly see by the crowd that follows Glenn Beck, predominantly white, on the fringe of mainstream society, an extremist message, as opposed to Dr. King, who was inclusive. Dr. King reached out to people of every ethnicity, of every culture, every community, multiple faiths, and all genders, and so it was an inclusive social movement. Today, if the rally for Glenn Beck was supposed to bring a parallel between his message and Dr. King's message, I think it sorely failed.
And yet, he did talk about everybody was born to be equal, and there was not a lot of the fiery language that I think a lot of critics were worried about. Reverend Lee, you want to comment on that?
Well, there's been a tremendous amount of pushback, and Glenn Beck claims to be a student of American history, but by his choosing this day to restore the honor, it took away the fiery message that he had been communicating, and he usually communicates in his pundit talk shows, but it had nothing to do with the dream of Dr. King at all. The dream of Dr. King is about equality and justice. It's about creating an equal playing field, and when you looked out at that audience today, you saw simply white people.
A response,
that's
Ted
not,
Hayes?
That's not true, simply white people. It doesn't matter what color you are. It sounds like the pastor is racially profiling people. You mean to tell me that because you're white, you cannot embrace the Dr. Martin Luther King dream? You know, Sharpton was talking about the message and the dream. You know what happened in this city just 2.5 weeks ago? A black church was burned to the ground by a Hispanic Latino person, and it was racially motivated, we believe. And we believe the person was an illegal alien. And we have not heard a word from Al Sharpton, we haven't heard a word from the mayor of the city, or no one has come out to decry what has happened. And if you really want to fulfill the dream of Dr. King, you should be here protesting the burning of that black church. And I haven't seen this pastor or any other pastors in this city come and defend or condemn.
We're talking
what
about Glenn Beck, who criminalizes undocumented people.
We're talking about
Glenn
you
Beck.
You are talking about words. We're talking about deeds. Where
Glenn,
is your deeds?
Glenn Beck,
you
who
have
called
led,
our
you
president a racist.
You reverends have led our black people down the blind road. We are leading in every negative social statistic in this country. It's because of you ministers have failed the dream of Dr. Martin Luther King. And now you want to blame white people?
No, it's we haven't wonderful. Failed the
it's
dream.
It's wonderful to see when white people have. Out there honoring Dr. Martin Luther King and our soldiers. And
all right, Mr. Hayes, let Reverend Lee respond.
But they were not honoring Dr. King. When you talk about equality and justice, when you're talking about freedom for all, then you would have an inclusive audience. Glenn Beck is not embracing the diversity of our country. The only ones that are following Glenn Beck are those who speak racism and discrimination, and it was a mockery on the anniversary of the I Have a Dream speech for Glenn Beck to be on that Lincoln Memorial saying that he's restoring the honor of our country.
If you and the reverends are so close and so clear about this, then why don't you obey Dr. King's dream when he said, I dream that the sons and daughters of the former slaves and the sons and daughters of former slave owners will come together at a table of brotherhood and work these things out. If Reverend Al Sharpton really cared about what's going on in this country, then he would go to Glenn Beck and sit down at the table of brotherhood and work these things out. But instead, he's sitting over there calling people names and accusing white people of being racist when they are the racists.
We're talking about the same Glenn Beck that called our president, the United States president, a racist.
What has he done for black people? President of the United States done for black people? You call him the black president, he supports illegal immigration.
He is the president of the United States.
Who you guys disobeyed
black.
Dr. Martin Luther King, who said you shall not judge by the person's skin color, but by the content of character. You voted for Barack Obama simply because of the color of his skin.
Who was in Glenn Beck's audience?
It doesn't matter.
That is exactly the point.
Most of the people in Al Sharpton's group was black. Okay, and one Hispanic, okay?
No, I'm sorry, the Secretary of Education, Arne Duncan, happens to be white.
Okay, whatever.
And he was there.
Whatever, there was just a few white people, mostly blacks. There's nothing wrong with that.
In Glenn Beck's speech today, he appealed to the Republicans, the Democrats, and the Independents. It was clearly a political agenda that he was pushing. When Dr. King was on the Lincoln Memorial, he reached out to people of every ethnicity, every faith, and it was an inclusive movement.
And Dr. King told us to do something that you reverends have not done. You have not brought the country together. You simply divide us more. And ever since Barack Obama has been president, the racial divide in this country has increased, and y'all know it.
And you blame that on African Americans?
No, I blame it on you. You, Pastor. You. Because here's a black church burned down in this city, and not one black minister has come out to investigate or call for its condemnation.
All right, that might be a little off topic here.
It is off topic, but it's the truth
because they're talking about words. We're talking about deeds. An evil deed has been done in this city, and where is the leadership?
All right, one more response from Reverend Lee before we go.
I think it was a mockery for Glenn Beck to be on the Lincoln Memorial today, claiming that he is reclaiming the dream of Dr. King when there was nobody that was there who needs to be working together at the table.
Alveda King was there.
Alveda King is not Dr. King. Alveda King is not Dr. King.
You guys are funny.
Right. Mr. Hayes Reverend Lee, thank you very much for joining us tonight for this rousing conversation. Thank you.
Thank you.
All right. I just want to go on record as saying I'd like to book Ted Hayes and Reverend Lee for next Saturday.
Yeah, that was a very interesting debate. Kathryn, you said you watched it more than one time? You watched it a couple of times.
Yeah, because I watched it fully once, but I had to, like I told you, I wasn't computer literate, and I had some issues of getting it on with the Adobe and flash drive. Found out I had it already. Mm-hmm. But it was very interesting, and the one thing I didn't like is the way they ended it with Dr. Lee having the final comment. I didn't like that part.
Yeah, and I want to say this. I finally got his name right. I want to say this about the Reverend Lee. You're part of the problem. And it's a travesty that you be over that organization that King once headed. You and those other people like you, you're a bunch of racists. And this idea that blacks can't be racist, that's an idea that came up, and I should have sent you that. I think you got that video as well.
I do have it, but blacks can be racist, too.
Yeah, they can be racist. You know? And this Reverend Lee is a good example of it. Let me just go back to some of the comments that you made. For you to make an issue of the fact that those persons out there in that mall were white, and for you to find that as an issue, makes that comment coming out of your mouth, Reverend, a racist comment. Because as Hayes said, are you saying that whites cannot, in fact, embrace the dream? What did you think King was talking about when he said that I have a dream that one day little black boys and little black girls will join their hands in brotherhood? What do you think they were talking about if he wasn't talking about whites being brought into the tent? And for you to make an issue of who was there, the issue was the fact that No one was excluded from that that march and that mall. And I'm very proud to say that I was there, and I saw what you were doing.
So black people were there.
Like you. We need to set you ministers down. You not all ministers, but ministers like you, Reverend Lee, because you are corrupt, along with Reverend Sharpton and Jesse Jackson. All of you are corrupt, and Jesse Jackson's corruption is chronicled in a book called Shakedown by Kenneth Timmerman, and that's what Jesse Jackson is doing for 40 years, just shaking down corporations, and we have not benefited from it yet. Hayes made this comment in the debate, and that was, black people are leading in every negative statistic in this country. And why is that, Reverend Al Sharpton and Jesse Jackson, under your so-called leadership? Under King, black people were advancing. And how is it that 40 years after Dr. King, black people were paralyzed and stopped in their tracks? And someone has to say this, that where you've been leading black people over a cliff, and this tape documents the kind of quote-unquote leadership that's standing in front of black America, leading black people nowhere. We're heading off a cliff with this leadership. Did you know that Ebony Magazine has an article out? By the way, I haven't read it, but one of my friends called and said that they have a article out right now where they are where the article goes into this leadership question, saying that we haven't really had any leadership since the 1970s.
Well, actually, I believe that some people still follow Reverend Sharpton and Reverend Jesse Jackson, but not a lot of us, especially the ones that can think for themselves. People who think for themselves can see through it all, just as well as Mr. Hayes. He's seen through it all, especially when he said it was Dr. Lee said there was only all white people there. Well, George was there. That's a black man. And then, you know, he said about him being all
there.
Black set the other.
I wasn't knowing I was there. I was there to go. I went there to give cover to this charge about racism. I went there, and I got licked to death.
Well, I don't believe that it was all black at the other one either. It had to be some whites there too, because whites also were part of that civil rights movement and also was a part of was there to hear the speech and the dream and all that, the message. So, you know, and then he gonna say Sharpton says they have the mall, but we have the message.
I want to know what that message is.
You know, and I'm saying, what is he doing here? That's making division right there.
Let me ask the Reverend Al. I shouldn't even question about his credentials, but I haven't seen anything come out of this man's mouth that make it even remotely appear this is a man of God. I ain't heard it, and I've been listening to this man for far too long. It's hard for me to listen to him, but when I listen to him, I don't hear nothing like God coming out of this man's mouth. And this reverend, that's another thing. That's another issue. How these reverends are sounding. I don't hear no God in their voice. And if you've heard God in this man's voice, I certainly have missed it. This man that says they have the dream said that Dr. King was for big government. This is the most ignorant comment that I think you can talk about in the same breath with King's name. It was big government that had people sitting in the back of the bus. What King was demonstrating against, and this shows you that Al Sharpton has no idea what the civil rights movement was about. It was reduce the role of government in the lives of people, particularly all those persons in the South. Why do you think people were sitting in the back of the bus? They had signs up, and the signs were in fact ordained by city ordinances passed by politicians. King was trying to get the government out of the place where the public domain was operative and trying to reduce the role of government. For this man to say that he was arguing for more government is nonsense. And it shows you how ignorant these people are. They're standing in front of black people. I'm calling him on the camera out about it without any hesitation, because this travesty, this misleading black people, has got to stop. And black people got to come up and say that these people are not speaking for us. Al Sharpton, Jesse Jackson, Ben Jealous, and this other guy ahead on there, this guy Lee, they're speaking for themselves. They don't have any constituency. And that's why in Washington, there were only 2,000 people, maybe about 3,000 people at this march, and they weren't there because of Sharpton. They went there to protest because they've been trained like seals to protest anything that white people do. If Sharpton had called that march by himself, they would have to say hundreds showed up and not thousands, trying to hide the fact that only a couple of thousand, maybe about 3,000 at most, showed up at this guy's rally. He didn't have any followers, anybody following this man. They have him on television making it appear that this man's a leader. Once they get him off TV, they'll find out that anybody following this guy. Who wants to hear what this guy got to say, talking about they have the dream? What dream are you talking about? And why don't you lay the dream out in front of us so we can see what you're talking about? Because so far, we haven't heard King in your voice. This is a travesty, and we've got to call these people out on them having sabotaged the black community by taking over and hijacking this movement, which is what you've done, all three of you. Jesse, Sharpton, Ben Jealous, and this guy they just had on there debating Hayes, all you know, none other than civil rights freaks. You've hijacked this movement. And none of you are speaking in the voice of King, not a single one of you. And that's a fact.
As he, Mr. Hayes asked him, where was he at? It was a black church that was set on fire there, burned to the ground. And you didn't hear not a peep from Reverend Sharpton at all about it. So what kind of issues are they standing up for today?
I'll tell you what the issues are.
No, I'm talking about what kind of issues are Reverend Jackson and Reverend Sharpton standing up for today?
Here's the civil rights movement in a nutshell. Whatever white people do, they're going to come out and complain about it. And that's the civil rights movement. Meanwhile, back at the ranch, the real issues that we need to be working on, such as the high school dropout rate.
Education. Black on black crime.
They're not even talking about those issues.
No, they don't.
Because there's no payoff in it. Anything that doesn't pay a dollar, they're not interested in getting out there in front of the camera and talking about it. In fact, when they get out there and talk, you can believe this, somebody is paying them to be quiet on certain issues. The only time they come out against anything is when they come out against those who are in the conservative movement, because there's no payoff over there. But they didn't criticize Reed for the comment that Harry Reid made when he said that Obama is acceptable because he doesn't speak in the Negro dialect. They didn't say anything about that. And when this Klansman named Byrd, who was in fact filibustering the civil rights movement, they didn't have any criticism of Byrd. He's in the right party, and he's where the payoff is. And so when this man died, he was a hero, yet this man was a member of the Klan. Can you get to that? A member of the Klan when he was 4 or 6 years old. They didn't have any criticism of that. They don't criticize Laura Schlesinger for having said, used the N-word when she was trying to explain to a caller something that the caller was asking her about, used the N-word to explain it in the context of the conversation.
Well, that caller was dumb to me. I mean, seriously, yeah. She was dumb. She married to a white guy, and then she calls in to one and asks, why do his family members call her? That was a dumb black woman. I'm just going to say the truth about it. She truly was. She knows she was married to him. She knows what's going on.
Yeah, you guys are.
Let's be real.
Yeah, you guys are. Look, you guys are jokes. Just like Hayes said, you know, you guys are funny. And when the community find out how you misled them, which is what John McWhorter has said and what Walter E. Williams has said, when they find out how they have been misled by these so-called civil rights leaders, which are nothing but a bunch of clowns in front of the black community. They find out how they've been misled by you so-called leaders. You're going to be in some real serious trouble with the black community and black people, because all you've done for 40 years is led us to a cliff.
But they have followers that's going to go with them over that cliff. They have some constituency, Reverend Jackson and Reverend Sharpton. They both have people that follow him. So a lot of them right here in Flint.
Yeah. I mean, nationwide, okay, there are 50 million black people in the United States.
Tom Joyner is one, because they both be on his show, but more so Reverend Sharpton is on there.
Mm-hmm. They have to go in there where people listen to the music. They try to bring Tom Joyner to Washington on the 28th because they thought he could bring the people listening to his music to that event, and they pull, 3,000 people. You know, the fact of the matter is that they want to claim these numbers. There are 50 million black people in this country. I will tell you this, their following is in the thousands. Okay, 50 million, okay, their followers in the thousands. That's 3,000 that you had in Washington, Sharpton. It's not tens of thousands, it's in the thousands. And this idea that you have this massive following, I ain't seen it.
Look at the number of blacks in D.C. area. They should be higher than that. It's just in their backyard, that rally was. So.
Sharpton is a phony, a fake, and a fraud. And let me just give you an example of that. Sharpton went down into Alabama, and he was actually spearheading the campaign. He went down there to campaign for Johnny Ford. Captain Johnny Ford is running for the state senatorial seat in a predominantly black district. He brought Sharpton in there, thinking that Sharpton could rally the crowd on his behalf, because the candidate was, in fact, the white candidate, a pharmacist, I think his name is Bailey. And Jennifer was trailing in the polls. He brought Shelton in. Now, Shelton went in there and said, this is a heir seat, H-E-I-R, meaning that this is a seat that we own because this seat comes out of the civil rights struggle, and therefore is an heir seat. The people went to the poll in this predominantly black district where Shelton went in there to show up the campaign of Johnny Ford, and the white candidate won, although Shelton was claiming that he was there to represent an heir seat. The black community didn't even listen to him in a predominantly black district. Where is his following, Shelton, that they're saying you have? You don't have any following.
He comes to Flint quite a bit, too.
And he goes to the churches.
For the same thing.
And he goes to the churches where people are already going to assemble because they're members of their church. You have an overflow crowd there, but that's because the church has a large gathering. I saw Jesse Jackson speak over here in Pasadena where the church was not that large, and that church was not filled. And Jesse Jackson, by the way, who was down in Detroit this past week, you probably heard about it. He was down there talking about the green movement and green jobs and all of this, is if they know how to create some jobs. And while he was in there inside the building, somebody went there and stole his car. And did you hear about that? That didn't make the news.
I didn't hear that one.
These people, these guys are jokes. And I have to give you my name where you want to think I'm trying to hide out from this. My name is George Moss, and I'm telling you that you're a bunch of clowns. And look me up. We have to have a conversation because I know what you're doing. And the black community is soon to find out about it. And when they do that, they're going to run you out of town on the rail because all you've done for 40 years is sit up here and pour water on King's dream. And just at Jackson, you started doing that at the moment that King drew his last breath on the balcony of the Lorraine Hotel, April the 4th, 1968. You began to horse that movement at that particular point in time by lying about having cradled King's head when he laid on that balcony floor, mortally wounded. You claim that you held King's head in your arms and cuddled him while he was, in fact, dying, breathing his last breath. That's a lie. Been documented by Barbara Reynolds and others. You lied. Abbott, they also called you on it. That's a lie, outright lie. And you've been lying ever since. And somebody's getting ready to call you on it. In terms of not just George Moss, the black community is going to call you on it because you're one of the ones that misled black folks also.
This is something I would truly love to see, is this type of setup where there is a debate, and I would like to see you with them,
yeah,
George.
Call me.
You know, or on a YouTube program or something with Reverend Sharpton and Reverend Jackson and Professor Moss.
Yeah, give me a call.
On there.
That's the number right there on the screen.
No, I would like to see him.
You're not gonna call.
This debate that went on between Eric Lee.
You're not going to call because
Ted Hayes.
I have some information to call you on, and you're not going to call. You want to talk into the abyss, and you can't talk into the abyss here because I understand where you're coming from, and I understand your history, where you set this thing up.
I don't know, Professor Moss. Sometime I think they may get the message. Somebody might call them and tell them, hey, watch his show sometime.
So. They know about the 2,000 hits we got because people call them and say this is what was being said. It's not a secret. They're not going to call up and...
Did we speak about them then?
I talked about Shelton on that program.
Okay.
And they're not going to call because they don't have anything to talk about other than this. We're going to talk about this hijacking of the civil rights movement. That's going to be the conversation. Jesse Jackson lying about cradling King's head on the back of the Lorraine Hotel on a picture that was taken April the 3rd, the day before King was assassinated. He was not on that balcony when King was shot. And that's another lie that he told. And then went to the city council the next day, April the 5th, wearing the blood of King, which I now know through Andy Young's testimony, he took the blood, put his hands in it, and wiped it on his shirt. That's how you got the blood on your shirt. And that's a matter of record also. And so when we have that conversation, which we're not going to have because you're not going to call, I wish you would call, but we're not going to have that conversation because you're not going to call.
It would be interesting.
Because you're not willing to have an honest conversation because you're dishonest and you are race merchants. You're race hustlers, all of you. And that's what you're doing to the black community. But somebody's going to call you on it very soon, and that's going to be in the name of the black community itself. Is going to find out what you've been doing. And then when they do that, they're going to run you out of town because you've been misleading the black community for the last 40 years, all you race hustlers.
Soon as black people start, some of them start thinking for themselves. Because a lot of them don't think for themselves. They like other people to think for them. And long as they have those kind of people, they will have some constituencies.
Yes. It's in the thousands, by the way. You know, 50 million black people. And this man who is a civil rights fraud, To one of Brawley's case, he had to pay $60,000 for this fraudulent claim that they made against Pagans and others in New York, where they were saying behind the scenes that we can actually get this in the media. We become the biggest, and use the N-word, the biggest N's in New York. And they used this fraudulent claim that Tawana Brawley had been raped and put in a bag and all that stuff they were claiming that was falsified. And Shelton was sued, and a court settlement, he lost a court case and had to pay in the, something like $64,000 to $65,000, because he had fraudulently made these claims. That's another example of this fraudulent movement that this man claims that he's heading. You know, we got to just simply have a conversation about these so-called leaders, because we are leaderless in Black America, and that's why we're in the condition that we're in. We're being led down the wrong pathway, away from King's dream. We've lost our moral bearings because we're listening to people who are nothing other than a bunch of racial hustlers. And it needs to be pointed out every chance we get, and we're pointing it out here now. Well, okay, that's
John. Enough. I thought you were going to say something.
I was going to say, I'm Chris Rock. Say, can you pick up your? Yeah, Chris Rock makes fun of Jesse Jackson. He even had him on a show one time. He asked Jesse Jackson point blank. He said, "What is your job? What do you do?" You know, it's like, "What is your job?" You know, and it's like he put it right to him. And I think he really wanted an answer, but I don't think Jackson gave him one. But
see, Chris Rock thinks for himself.
Yeah, that's what pretty much. Well, about the barbershop, the movie Barbershop.
These guys are jokes.
They were sitting around mocking Jesse Jackson and Al Sharpton.
Yeah, if Chris Rock said, we had leaders like Malcolm X and Martin Luther King who inspired us, and he said, and now comes along these substitute teachers. And he's talking about Jesse Jackson and Al Sharpton. These people are these are like substitute teachers. The real deal are those leaders we had back in the 60s when we had moral grounding and we had a vision of what it was we were trying to do with the country. We were all embracing the vision of this nation and trying to get it to live up to its true ideals.
But it was still division there because of Martin Luther King and Malcolm X. So it was still some division going on.
Honestly, honest divisions can occur. People won't always agree on the same points, you know,
right?
Because people have honest disagreements.
Because some wanted
this
to
is
be
something different here.
Peaceful, but they found out actually when the people think for themselves, they seen for themselves that it couldn't be done peacefully.
Yeah. See, you can.
That's
why
the riots went on.
You can have honest disagreements, and that's what Malcolm and Martin had. Do you remember that one comment that Malcolm made when he said, they'll come to you telling you that I'm for separation and you're for integration to keep us fighting among ourselves. He said, no, I'm not for separation. He says, what you and I are for is freedom. Only you think the integration gets you freedom. I think separation gets me freedom. We both have the same objective. We just got different ways of getting at it. So that's an honest conversation that Malcolm was having.
Yeah, because that was what Malcolm was about. It was about freedom.
It was an honest, you know, disagreement between two men, both of whom had a vision of how to get to the goal line.
Mm-hmm.
And King's idea was to embrace the American vision and to perfect that vision. Malcolm's idea was to, in fact, it was impossible, given the history of the country, and then to separate the people out of the nation for their freedom that they had been denied inside the United States. It's an honest disagreement that they were having, but both men were in fact trying to bring a resolution to the problem.
Do you remember the picture where Malcolm and Martin first met? They were shaking hands. That was the first time they ever seen one another. Yeah.
And only time.
Only time is because they didn't want them. If those two had came together, and I believe Martin, one of the things Martin was finally realizing that it could not be done peacefully.
Yeah.
That is one of the reasons he was hooking up with Malcolm.
Well,
and the government was not going to have this much power between, it was too much power between these two men.
That picture has been really misappropriated and misapplied. That picture was where King was going out of one of the doors of the congressional building, and Malcolm saw him going out that door and ran around to hit him off and made him shake his hand. It wasn't that they were actually meeting anywhere. Malcolm.
No, they weren't. It was not. It was just by chance that they happened to be in the same space at the same time.
Martin was not going to leave his nonviolent movement, not because of Gandhi, but because of Martin's Christianity. We talk about Martin, the Gandhi idea about that Martin was in
fact following.
The
thing about Christianity, God also had a warring spirit.
Right.
Okay, so somewhere in there, my understanding is that he had got to a point that he kind of knew that this was not going to end peacefully.
But Martin was saying, when they were criticizing Martin, about certain things that Martin was in fact doing, because he was getting off the page what they had written as what the Civil Rights Arena was about. Martin said, "I've been working too long and too hard now against segregation to segregate my moral concern." Martin was on his mission. And the militants were out there too, and Martin was saying that this marvelous new militancy, but he was not going to embrace this Black Power advocacy as
he wasn't going to embrace Malcolm X's thoughts or whatever that he had on this coming to this freedom that Malcolm has or being a nation or whatever. But he did. I'm gonna show it to you. Right. I'm gonna bring it I'm gonna bring it to you. Where he did come to the, if it just went through, it was a thought he had that this was not going to end peacefully. There was too much hatred among white people against blacks.
Well, he wasn't, I tell you what you'll show me. If you show me that, you'll show
I'm
me that Martin.
It to
okay,
you.
What you'll show me is that Martin is saying that unless they
he
adopt
didn't change
the vision that he had.
He didn't change his vision.
It would not end in peace, but Martin was not advocating going down the road of where peace
violence.
No, Martin was not.
No, he didn't.
That. Okay,
but he had these thoughts.
Of course.
Okay.
If
and
know.
He had these. My thing is, the man had the thoughts. Okay, he was human. He went through a lot of stuff. He also realized that they were trying to kill him. He had thoughts.
Well, Martin was killed by violence.
And he wrote,
but
those
he wasn't
thoughts.
Advocating violence. I think the point is that it
which
that,
came out. After the fact, after he was dead, this stuff came out.
Yeah, but if Martin, if you don't embrace Martin's vision, then inevitably it is going to be a conflict between the groups. Martin was trying to bring the groups together. If that vision is not accepted, then what's going to prevail is, of course, violence. The conflict is going to be on. But Martin was not an advocacy of that bringing that result about. Martin wrote a book called Where Do We Go From Here? He also wrote another book called Why We Can't Wait. And we can't wait because the hour is too late. And where do we go from here? Martin was saying where we go from here is we go from here to go get our guns.
I got the tape on that. I got all them old tapes. But he did have the thought. And he went to the Lord and asked the Lord to help him with that.
Okay.
Okay.
Now, what you going to show me next week, 2 weeks from now, when you come back on the second of... What you going to bring in?
You got 3 minutes, George.
Okay. Well, now, tell me what you going to bring in so I'll know what to get
I'm
gonna prepared
bring
for.
In. I got to find it.
What are you going to bring in, Kathryn, so I'll be able to be ready
thoughts.
For it?
His thoughts. His thoughts on this not, that thoughts of this trying to bring integration, freedom, was not going to be done peacefully.
Okay. I tell you what, Kathryn, if you bring that in here and show me that King was advocating.
He didn't advocate it. I didn't say he did. I said thoughts now.
Okay.
He had a lot of thoughts on different things. That didn't come out until after the man was dead.
Pink.
But he had thoughts.
King was trying.
And he would always go to the Lord. He always would go to the Lord.
Listen, Sharpton,
and get his strength.
Yeah, let me say this, Sharpton. This is you confuse civil rights frauds. King was trying to head off a racial conflagration. In other words, a conflict between the races, which you're trying to stir up. King was trying to head that off. And what Kathryn's going to actually show me next week is that King was warning the nation, clarion call, that if this vision that he had was not embraced by this nation, it was not going to end well.
It wasn't going to end peacefully.
Yeah, but the advocacy
was... And it didn't.
It took King's life.
Thank you. But, and then the riots began. It didn't end peacefully. Let's be real here.
Yeah, but let's not get that mixed up with the vision that King had in terms of
I'm
how
not mixing
to,
it up with his vision, but the man had thoughts. When people are trying to kill you, bombing your home, trying to threaten your family, spitting on you, stabbing you with an inch of your heart, you sit and you get to thinking about what is really going on. Is this really... I got this vision, and I know the Lord gave me this vision, but... Is it going to end peacefully? Mm-hmm. And it didn't. He died.
Oh, yeah.
He was assassinated. That's not peacefully.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and you. I think we're on the same page here, but bring that in.
I'm going to bring it in.
Kathryn, be back on the second.
I'm here on the second and the fourth Mondays.
Okay, we got to wrap up. We're running out of time here as always. Kathryn, it's good to have you back. Want you to follow your dreams, and if you don't follow your dreams, as always, we always say here that if you don't follow your dreams, you'll never know what's on the other side of the rainbow.
Amen.
You gotta have a dream. Everybody's got a dream. God gave it to you. If you don't have a dream,